Hello and welcome back to Vinyl Friday, where I go through my records in alphabetical order like a big nerd and talk about why I love them. We're going to be doing things a little bit differently around these parts today because it turns out that the song that I had intended to do is one that my sister, friend of the channel, has particularly strong feelings about. So rather than having me all to yourselves for the next 20 or 30 minutes, I'm going to be crossing to my transnational correspondence throughout the video. So basically what we're going to do is go through a laundry list of our favorite things about today's song, which is... Hi! Livin Thing from the 1976 album A New World Record. Alright, here's what we're gonna do. First, we're going to have a listen to the music and take some notes.
Then we're gonna listen to the lyrics and take some notes.
And then we'll have a little chat about our findings.
Okie dokes. See you in 3 minutes and 33 seconds.
I can hear her through this earbud and she's singing along to the backing vocals.
Taking a dive. Taking a dive.
Okay, I finished both listens.
Okay, me too.
Let's jump into our list. One, how this song, from verse to verse, charts the trajectory of a relationship.
The first verse, the relationship's good. It's like magic. More melancholy themes in the second verse. You
look back
in time
to the first day. Looking back on the beginning of the relationship that was really good.
Mm-hmm.
Then...
third verse, accepting your fate. Taking a dive cause you can't help the slide floating downstream. Let her go, don't start spoiling the show. Which reminds me thematically of... hold on, what's that song? It was on that compilation CD that you made for me that I used to have in the old car all the time.
God.
I will think of it. The theme is basically, you said the relationship is over, so I'm not going to get in your way. That same kind of like helpless acceptance of a relationship ending.
Is it by Tower of Power?
Ooh, yes, maybe, potentially. So I wish I still had that CD because that was a great compilation. But then...
But then...
new backing vocals. Don't you do it, don't you do it. Don't you fall back into this unsuccessful relationship with this person. So is there maybe a bit of a cyclical thing going on?
Maybe it's like, see you tonight. It's a bad idea, right? See you tonight!
But it's fine.
I think it's like the 1976 version of that.
Yeah. Cool. You're getting kind of pulled back in. So this entire song gives you the feeling of being in a giant ocean. You're just kind of being pushed around by the swells and you don't really have any agency in the situation, if that makes sense.
Two, word painting. Do you know what word painting is?
Yes.
Is this a thing where you're like, yeah, I totally know what that means. Word painting is when you have a set of lyrics and you write the music so that they illustrate what the words are describing.
They're mapping onto each other. They're functioning in dialogue.
Let's dig into that. All of the imagery in the song is of going up and down and up and down. Our song opens on the line, sailing away on the crest of a wave. Huh. Rolling, riding, slipping, sliding. You took me higher and higher. Higher
and
higher,
baby. And then I'm taking a dive. Mm.
We're up, we're down, we're up and down. It's all about lifting up and sliding down or falling down or diving down. Like it's...
so it's a song about prepositions.
It's a song about prepositions, exactly. Preposition! So lyrically, the song is about rising and falling. It is about the ups and the downs of a relationship. Here's how it's achieving that musically. Let's have a listen to how he sings the line, Sweet Desire. Huge swoops. And the way he sings it, at the crests and the troughs, he mm-hmm. increases the volume, and then while he's sliding, he pulls back. I mean, that sounds very technical, but really gives you the sense that you're being, like, thrown around by this song. Higher and higher, baby. Do you see? The music is painting a picture of the words. Word painting. Here's another example. Have a listen to these arpeggios right at the end of the song.
Arpeggios, that's the word. Sorry, please continue.
And they're really dramatic, like spanning multiple octaves. It's up, it's down, it's up, it's down. What's an arpeggio, you ask? The piano correspondent will show you. Won't you, piano correspondent?
I will. Let's take a G major chord. That's what it sounds like altogether. This is what it sounds like as an arpeggio. Broken it into its constituent parts, you can play arpeggios many ways.
Arpeggios can go up
or down.
Or they can go up and down.
Can go up multiple octaves. The world is your arpeggiated oyster. Have fun with it, kids.
Everything about the song is in the first two lines, sailing away on the crest of a wave, rolling and riding and slipping and sliding. So he tells us exactly what's gonna happen. Three, this song's flamboyant introduction.
Having watched Final Friday last week, we now know that ELO likes a dramatic opening. They haven't disappointed here.
What influences do we feel Jeff Lynne is drawing from in putting... Hi! What influences do we think Jeff Lynne is drawing from in putting together this introduction?
This one sounds kind of Spanish flamenco inspired to me. Like I almost see a matador or something. Trumpets at the very end of the opening proclaiming this entry, the beginning of the song. I guess maybe more paso doble. It has like that feeling.
I don't know what the main correspondent is called, like the host of Vinyl Friday.
The anchor?
Yes, I'll get the Vinyl Friday anchor to research this and report back later. A paso doble is a Spanish military march. Which, as I understand it, was designed to be literally fast-paced so that the infantry soldiers could get in like 120 steps per minute. That makes it sound like they're trying to get their steps in for the day with their little Fitbits. No, I mean just that they could keep up a walking pace of 120 steps per minute, which I think is about this fast. Kind of curious to see how close I was. It reminds me so much of the dance that... Oh, what's his name? What is Morticia Adams' husband's name, please?
Gomez.
Gomez, yes. It's like the dance that Gomez and Morticia Adams do.
Yeah.
It has that kind of high dramatic flair. Four. This song's abrupt pivot from something that is extremely flamboyant and extremely dramatic to something that is far less exotic and more recognizable. Maybe even a bit more pedestrian. You think the whole song's gonna be like that, the whole song's gonna be in this like minor key and high drama and lots of exciting things happening. Strings, violin, trumpet. And then it goes to C major. I think it's in C major. Hang on. Yeah. Rock song!
Yeah.
Which I suppose takes us into the verse.
Wait, we haven't spoken about more caveman boom booms to really tell us that we're about to start something.
Five, the caveman boom booms. Side note, there's a dog in our neighborhood named Boom Boom, and I think that's the funniest name for a dog I've ever heard.
It's like a judge banging the gavel. Boom, boom, order in the courtroom.
Yeah, you're right. Boom, we're into the song. Six, the little strumming flourish at the top of the first verse. He's doing kind of like a trill, so he goes... Did you catch it that? Dug-a-dung, dung, dung.
Which adds a nice, interesting rhythmic element.
The chicka-cha. I think it calls back to that flamenco slash Spanish influence. That sort of triplet thing shows up a lot in that kind of music. I don't know whether or not that's intentional, but Jeff Lynne did seem to do things in a very intentional way.
Yeah.
I think everything that he does in his recordings is a decision as opposed to an accident. 8. The way that Jeff Lynne conveys the concept of sweet desire.
I think this is my favorite part of the entire song. Specifically, something about the way that he sings, "You and your sweet is so good." And then the "oh" at the end of "you took me
oh"
higher and higher is just so like, oh, this person is so hot.
The swoops are quite something. He sounds like he's overcome with desire.
It's magic.
What's the word I'm looking for? It's not lecherous.
No, but like a little bit hot under the collar, right?
I'm gonna search for a synonym that is appropriate for the internet. Now, I'm not looking for a synonym for honey, internet. Here are some others that might be appropriate. Here you go, you ready?
Yeah.
Excited.
Mm-hmm.
Titillated.
Mm-hmm.
Amorous.
Sure.
Inflamed.
Inflamed.
Impassioned.
Yeah.
On fire.
All of these.
Concupiscent.
Yes, use that one.
He sounds concupiscent. It's amazing though how much in one O he communicates so many things that take so much more work to put into words.
Right. Yeah, no, that's true. And I also think it's interesting because just the movement of the melody downwards.
I'm going to interrupt you one more time. That's the sound of biting on your lip and your eyes rolling up.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm not going to demonstrate that.
Good.
I'm going to try and find that Emma Stone gif.
Or the Marlon Brando one. But he somehow manages to make that O not a negative feeling, even adding the little trill on you. And you! And your sweet desire. You know what I'm saying. Yeah.
Are there any other songs that have a swoop like that? There've got to be other songs that
hold
have
on,
swoops.
Hold on, let me think. I've thought of one.
What is it?
Take me down into paradise. Don't be scared, 'cause I'm your
body type. Yes,
yes,
that's a good one.
Thank you.
I'd also like to cut in on my own show and take a second to acknowledge just what a sweet singing voice Jeff Lynne has. We probably don't give him the credit that he deserves. I guess he doesn't really have a particularly distinctive voice, but it's very sweet and very accurate. I found this video this week of a recent Jeff Lynne performance. I think it's from last year. So he is now a man in his mid-70s, and this is what he sounds like. Compared to his contemporaries, his pitching is fantastic. There's a cleanness and a clarity to his tone. And this is at a point in his life where most of his contemporaries are not really able to hold a tune so much anymore. A lot of the other musicians that he was coming up with were hitting the cigarettes a lot harder and other unmentionables, whereas it seems that he didn't really go for that quite as much as the others. Every time I watch a video of him performing live, I'm struck by how well he sings. I mean, even Paul McCartney thinks he sings well.
He's got a really beautiful voice, you know. It's not easy to do what he does.
Number 9, how Jeff Lynne can make C major sound interesting. I see C major as the most basic of keys. It's so simplistic. It's the key that children learn piano on because there are no black keys in that scale. I always find it a little bit docile, maybe even boring. So to go from that sort of high drama intro to C major, little baby C major, is quite a shock.
But I feel like it's a testament to Jeff Lynne's songwriting skills that he makes basic C major sound not very basic at all.
I think that what he's doing to achieve this is that he's using C major as a starting point, and then he takes a whole bunch of left turns. Really unusual choices.
And discombobulating.
I'm very pleased with this one because I like the chords. I think the chords are really interesting.
They're kind of like couplets of chords, and they go in totally different areas in a way that's unusual. Piano correspondent's gonna show us what I mean by that. This first pairing of chords is not unusual. In fact, he used it in Telephone Line, which we saw in last week's episode.
Oh, Telephone Line! Give me some time!
Living in
twilight.
However, it is very unusual to go from here to here to here. Ooh, colorful. And similarly, this chord to this chord. We've all heard something like that before, except that it lands on this. Again, unusual. So altogether, he's doing this.
Thank you.
I respect that.
10. How the strings get their very own melodies.
Strings are doing very inventive and specific things.
Let's take verse 1 as an example.
So they start with like a bum, 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 bum.
Bum, bum.
When it gets to the you and your sweet desire, the strings go dun, 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 dun. So it's like they're doing a totally different thing in the background, like they're singing their own totally separate song. And that's what I mean about Jeff Lynne taking a very intentional approach to his music. Those are not little incidental lines, assuming he wrote the string parts, which I am. He's written essentially two melodies for this verse, so I like that.
I mean, I was going to say, I really feel like the strings are the second protagonist in this song.
That's like ELO's mission statement. The strings are our second protagonist.
Livin! The ambiguous lyrical content at the chorus.
Chorus, let's go.
It's a living thing. Do-do-do-do-do-do.
What's a living thing? What the hell is this song about?
I don't know. Something that's terrible to lose. The relationship is a living thing?
Yeah, like maybe the love in the relationship is like an organism, a creature in its own right.
Yeah. The chorus is one that you kind of want to like bang your fist against a table, you know, in time, or like stomp in time.
March.
It's yeah, a marching time. Song.
It's a living thing. It's a terrible thing.
It doesn't quite have that we're all in a pub singing along, but I think there is an element of a kind of shared experience.
You know how I think he establishes that?
The percussion.
I don't think it's only the percussion. I think it's that also he's singing the high falsetto, he's also singing an octave below that, and then he's singing harmonies in between. So, and it's kind of rough.
Listen especially to the one that goes, "It's a living thing!" He's kind of shouting that one. It's a living thing!
If you listen to the backing vocals and like telephone line, the line that I demonstrated last week with the doubled up harmonies.
They've all faded out of view.
That's a very like tightly produced harmony. It sounds like it's just glued together. Whereas with this, the vocals aren't as tight and some of them are sort of sung with wild abandon.
It's a terrible thing to lose.
Yeah, it definitely has that pub sound. I think Some of them are kind of like shouting.
13! The bit where Jeff Lynne sings, "Hot diggity dog!"
Normally if I do a lyrics listen, I don't need any reference. I can just listen to the lyrics from the recording, but I actually had to have a set of lyrics in front of me for this one because At the end of the chorus,
"And I'm taking a dive!"
Yes, what for years I thought was, "Hot diggity dog!" You could hear that it was, "I'm taking a dive"?
I think so. I'm not sure now, but I think so. I could at least identify dive, because he said dive before.
No, that's dog. Hot diggity dog.
Hot diggity dog.
14. The echo at the very end of the chorus.
Is it here also where the dive goes, "Dive, dive, 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 dive"? Doppler effect.
That's not the Doppler effect, but yeah.
You know what I mean.
Quick physics lesson, the Doppler effect is when...
when the ambulance goes past and it goes... like that, right?
The Doppler effect.
Yeah, it's to do with the sound waves. That's your physics lesson for the day. It's to do with sound waves. But this is just an echo. Here we go. Oh yeah, that's a great echo. Dive, 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 dive. It sounds like he's falling.
Into a cave.
Somewhere deep.
Far away from us. Into an oubliette.
15. The way that the strings and the vocals do a call and response at the chorus.
It's a living thing.
We're gonna do the same thing as last week. This is the vocals, this is the strings. Here we go.
It's a given thing. What a terrible thing to lose.
16. There are more unusual chords in this chorus.
Oh, diminished chords. There was a real doozy of a diminished chord in the last episode. On telephone line. But this one has a diminished chord, I think. Let me just double check that.
Unaugmented. Oh, that's exciting.
Woo.
Here it comes. It begs for resolution, and he gives it to us. An augmented chord is kind of the opposite of the diminished chord that we talked about last week. Loosely. Don't come for me, music theory nerds. I love you, but you can be a little uptight sometimes. No offense. The piano correspondent will show you.
So as the anchor said, as we're calling her now apparently, last week we looked at the diminished chord, where in the example from last week you take a minor chord and you shrink it in a little bit by a semitone, which in this case means you make this note, ooh, hideous, tantalizing. In the case of this song, we're taking a major chord, and we're stretching it a little bit, so we're taking that last note and we're moving it up a semitone, like this. Ooh, also ugly and tantalizing, because it creates a point of tension that we really want resolved, and that's what makes music nice. What a terrible thing to... Resolution. Back to you.
17! All of the backing vocals in the second verse.
There are some oohs and ahs. It really kind of thickens the sound, but also raises the stakes, I think.
If he had given those backing vocal parts to the strings, the song would have kind of ceased to be a rock song and become something far more orchestral than it already is. And it might have been too string heavy. It would have started to sound like a quartet set to drums. You've spoken to what I think is probably my favorite element of this song.
18! The way that Jeff Lynne builds up his verses. All of those backing vocals that we just pointed out don't exist in the first verse. The first verse is much emptier. So you can really clearly hear some acoustic guitar, some piano, drums, bass. Second verse.
But in the second verse, the bump, 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 bump carries through the verse. It's not just introducing the verse, it is running through the verse. Behind that, there's like a little warm drone of strings. And then as you say, there's the, I'm taking a dive, which sounds like a woman's voice.
19! The way that Susie Quattro's sister is singing backing vocals on this track.
According to the Wikipedia page.
Oh, you have looked it up already. Yeah.
Patty Quattro sang uncredited vocals, particularly the higher and higher part. Patty Quattro being part of the Pleasure Seekers, a 60s era all-female rock band from Detroit.
Cool. But I mean I did pass 21, but wow, what a way to die! If she's not credited, let's credit her right now. The backing vocal is sung by none other than Patty Quattro.
They had a cute look.
Oh! They are known due in large part to later prominence of band member Susie Quattro.
All my life I wanted to be somebody and here I am!
That's cool. I love that.
I think she's the I'm taking a dive and the don't you do it,
don't you do it,
and higher and higher. 20! That Gregorian chant thing.
Oohs and ahs.
Ooh, which turns to ah. And at this point it starts to become choral. This is not your standard love song.
It almost sounds like a Gregorian chant at the end of chorus 2.
We're not yet at chorus 2.
I know, okay, sorry.
Spoilers. I'll forgive it.
Thanks.
That's all I have to say about the verse, actually, so maybe we are at the chorus.
Yeah, I think we are at chorus 2.
Chorus 2!
I think it's basically identical to chorus 1, apart from this Gregorian chant at the end. Specifically, I think it's under the I'm taking a dive part.
It sounds like 40 men standing in a room singing, ah!
Yeah, exactly. In my head, they're also in like monastic robes. And they're all holding a candle and they're in a Gothic cathedral.
Maybe I'll AI an image for this. It goes fully choral by the end. It's so dramatic. So rousing.
21. The sheer immensity of the third verse.
All hell is breaking loose.
Verse 3. Let's do a stock take of everything that's happening in verse 3. We've got our bump, 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 which is a little bit louder. We've got our warm bed of strings at the bottom, except one of them is higher, so there's a higher level now. It's like a double layered pool of strings at the bottom. And then you're right, they split apart and harmonize. I'm sure that was very beautiful. The strings have a new melody over I'm Taking a Dive. The oohs and ahs are louder. Instead, ooh, ah, it's ooh, ah.
Oh, and the oh my god, what is that word?
Arpeggios.
Thank you.
There are four notes for every beat there. That's frenetic. That's hectic. Editor Nancy showed me this really neat video of this arpeggio being played in a live setting. It is so much more impressive when you have a visual display of what's happening. It's vast. It's spanning multiple octaves.
What were some of the words that we found instead of dramatic? Hair-raising, stirring.
Electrifying.
It's
electrifying.
It's very zingy. Electrifying is a good word for it.
Okay, good. We'll go with those. It's just very big. The personality of this song is very big. And then we've got, yeah, our caveman drums going into that last chorus. Bum, 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 bum. Basically, this verse has everything that the other verses have had, cumulatively, just built up. You're right, it's a wall of sound. It is almost a Phil Spector approach. For those playing at home, Phil Spector's the producer who ended up coming in, much to Paul McCartney's chagrin, and finishing off Let It Be. He's the person who is responsible for those, I'm gonna get crucified for this, but revolting, overly saccharine string sections, choral parts, through like Long and Winding Road. But he also did a lot of early to mid 60s music. The anchor will show you some examples now. Oh, all right, here's a wall of sound montage. Because everything comes back to the Beatles. And finally, number 22! The pizzicato strings right at the end. There's a cute little pizzicato arpeggio on the fade out.
Oh, that was what I had notes about.
Ah, excellent. Great minds.
I had plucky strings at end of final chorus.
Correct. Yeah, that's what pizzicato means. It's when strings are plucky.
Plucky strings.
As opposed to flowy. It's dum 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 dum.
Love an arpeggio though. I think they're a very useful songwriting tool because they kind of hook you and you can't get away with them. It's like you're riding the musical roller coaster and you can't get off.
Do you mean that it's sort of like you're rolling and riding and slipping and sliding?
Yeah.
Finally, some parting thoughts. The first about ELO's relationship to the post-Beatles Beatles.
I'm reading the comments under the official ELO Living Thing page on YouTube. And then there's a comment, and I want you to verify this for me as the Beatles correspondent. It says, John Lennon and also Paul McCartney once said that ELO is what the Beatles would have eventually sounded like if they'd continued as a band into the 70s and beyond. What do we think of this claim?
Ooh, that's a good question. John Lennon did call them the sons of the Beatles, but the Beatles all went in totally different directions afterwards. Like, John Lennon was putting out extremely sparse music after the Beatles broke up. Like, if you listen to the song Mother, it's so empty. Like, I don't want John Lennon to hijack this episode, but I think that he had just been through so much and felt so depleted that his music sounded like the music of a man who had been drained. Whereas George Harrison went in totally the opposite direction, and actually a very ELO direction, and went for dialing everything up to 11, wall of sound. Paul McCartney did like a back to his roots thing, just like recording his little tunes at his farm in Scotland.
Looking for a home in the heart of the country.
So it's really hard to know what the Beatles would have done if they hadn't broken up, because they all had a lot to get out of their systems. They had kind of done this big orchestral thing, and as we know, they don't like doing the same thing twice. So I think they sort of established their legacy and then handed it over, and ELO picked up the torch.
I have two thoughts. My first thought is that ELO is too stylistically ornate. Like, the Beatles can do maximalism, but I think there's an embellished quality to ELO that the Beatles don't have, and I'm not sure they would have had. You know, ELO does do disco, and I also can't really see the Beatles doing disco, the genre that was born out of marginalized communities. I don't think I can see the Beatles getting into that as a genre of their own accord.
I mean, Paul McCartney did flirt with it, but...
Yeah, but Paul McCartney is a very different thing from the Beatles. But I also think, while obviously ELO was inspired a lot by the Beatles, they are their own thing, and we shouldn't speak about them only in relation to, I guess, the Beatles.
I think Jeff Lynne does make it kind of difficult for you to not draw the comparison. But a complaint that a lot of people make about ELO is that it's like if the Beatles were varnished. You know, like it's too polished and too perfect. But I don't mind that.
See, I really don't feel like I hear that much Beatle.
Maybe it's because the Beatles are so pervasive.
In my life, because I grew up with you. Maybe.
You're welcome.
It might also be that I discovered ELO much later in life, and so I think of them as two completely different beasts. I only heard about their connections, again, kind of much later, so.
In the documentary that I watched that was recommended by someone in the comments, Paul McCartney says,
you know, when I heard ELO, it was very what we'd been doing on Sgt. Pepper. The sort of cellos, you know, very much what we'd been into, very sort of mathematical strings. And so I think the first thing was, oh, that's, I know where he got that from. But then you can't resist it. It's just so good. You go, oh God, it's a bloody good song. Wish we'd done that one.
Interesting. Interesting though then that this relationship hasn't turned into what we've seen with, what's that band that everyone always compares to Led Zeppelin?
Oh, Greta Van Fleet.
Yeah. Compares negatively.
I think it's because Jeff Lynne's music is good enough in its own right that you can value it for its songwriting quality separately from its arrangement choices. Whereas I think that Greta Van Fleet are writing songs like Led Zeppelin, in addition to like matching their guitar tones to Jimmy Page's guitar tones and doing similar style drum fills. And I think everyone's issue with Greta Van Fleet is that they lack originality, which is not an accusation that you can level against Jeff Lynne.
I think also it probably helps Jeff Lynne's case that the Beatles had disbanded by the time, you know, by the 70s.
Can I tell you a secret? Led Zeppelin has also disbanded.
Well, yes, but he's writing music less than a decade after the Beatles have been a thing, whereas Greta Van Fleet is writing music, taking a lot of inspiration from Led Zeppelin, kind of 40 years after. You know, Jeff Lynne took a lot of inspiration from the Beatles, but I think it's without that added nostalgia factor that I think Greta Van Fleet and Led Zeppelin have in their pairing, if that makes sense.
Yeah. That does make sense.
Jeff Lynne is writing music that is of its own time in conversation with like soft rock and disco.
And also some thoughts on Jeff Lynne's incomprehensible lyrics.
In the vein of incomprehensible lyrics from Jeff Lynne, the one that always gets me is,
don't bring me down, Proust.
Like, I think he's singing about Proust. I'm pretty sure.
I always thought it was Bruce. Don't bring me down, Bruce. We're not quite done. We've got some questions for you. I think we've come across two questions that we can ask the dear viewers in their living rooms or on their toilets or wherever it is that they watch this. My question is, can you think of any other songs that have like a vocal that swoops up and down like Jeff Lynne's does in this song? And Anna, what's your question?
My question is, what is the living thing? Do we think it is the relationship? Do we think it's something else? What is Jeff Lynne talking about here?
What the hell is this song about? Tell us, please. Any other parting thoughts, or are we Are we good?
No, just that I'm really enjoying this ELO mini-series.
Oh, good. I'm glad.
I think that's it. If you enjoyed this episode and or you would like to support any of the weird things that we do, by we, I mean me multiplied, so really the weird things that I do, like referring to myself as many people, I'll leave a link in the description where you are most welcome to make a donation to my Buy Me a Coffee page, but you're not obliged. No pressure, friends.
That's it from us.
Thanks for hanging out with us.
I'll see you here next week. Have a great weekend!
You remember that thing that had like conjunction junction?
What's your function?
Yeah, I'm sure there's one about prepositions, but I don't know how you would find that. Anyway, please continue. Sorry. Scatterbrain today.
Baby. And your sweet desire.
You took me. Can you please splice in a little clip of John Travolta singing, "It's electrifying," after we say electrifying?
Yes, I could definitely do that.
Thank you. Pizzicato. To live and then.
What? My question is, I forgot what my question is.
16! No, that's 12. 16. 16. 16 minutes left. Get ready, game on! Nineteen! God, I really lack the coordination for this job. 19. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3.
Oh, you clapped on 4 that time.
Oh, you're right. Okay, ready?
Which one are we doing?
We'll clap on the 3.
Okay.
Okay, ready? Mm-hmm. 1, 2, 3.